Good afternoon, everyone, and it is a hard act to follow because Professor Kondapalli has already set the stage for the large threat that we do see in the region. I'd like to thank Air Marshal Mukul for his kind words, Air Marshal Chopra, the Center for Air Power Studies, for inviting me here. But I do want to make the point that the idea of looking at regional security challenges is actually a subject on its own, a subject in terms of the way we look at them, rather than just what they are. So what I hope to do in the next 15 minutes or so is to list them out, certainly, but also to encourage that we have to find new ways of looking at these problems. How do I turn this on? Yes, this is the one. Thank you. I begin with this often provocative picture because this is the impression we have of our region. As we grow up in India, and I speak to schools a lot of the times, I'm always disappointed by the fact that I meet less and less young people who will talk to me about neighbors from across land and maritime boundaries. Most people would actually think of travel as something, travel abroad as something you would get into a plane and go to another destination for. It begins perhaps Dubai to our west and Singapore to our east, but our more natural boundaries are not something that are inculcated amongst the youth. And I understand that there are reasons for it. We obviously have so many challenges with each of our neighbors. But this is something that we have to try and look at differently. Because if we are not to see India's region as a ring of fire that encircles India, and instead start to look at it more as a region, as a ring of security, India would be able to use its region much more as a force multiplier than what is the present situation. So I'm going to go through each of these threats. The first one is the latest one, really. What has happened to our western frontier if we... I'm just going to leave it there because I think I mixed up the presentation I was supposed to send you. If we look at the West and the most recent, because obviously the challenge from Pakistan, the one of cross-border terror, the one of the LOC, as well as at the international boundary where there are attempts at narco smuggling, gun smuggling, and all the rest, those are well known. But very recently, and I've just come back from Abu Dhabi from an Indian Ocean region conference, where External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar listed what he called four worrying and concerning developments for India. In fact, he said it was the four concerns for the Indian Ocean region. And he divided them into two. Two were trends and two were developments. So the two big trends, if you like, was the retrenchment of US power from the East. It's very significant that it is India's foreign minister who is saying that. He said America is less inclined to put its boots on the ground. It's less inclined to get involved in a direct way. It increases India's responsibilities, but it also is a bit of a concern when one of the world's biggest powers, in fact, for the moment, the biggest, is actually seeking some kind of retrenchment in its power. The second, he said, was China's rise, managing China's rise. And the fact that we are seeing more territorial aggression, we are seeing much more, throwing away, if you like, of previous agreements. The two developments he spoke about were the U.S. pullout from Afghanistan. Again, very significant because till now, what we have heard from our leadership, from our diplomats, has been that India and the U.S. are on the same page. We are on similar pages when it comes to Afghanistan. Yes, of course. We are on the same page if we're talking about a worry for terrorism in Afghanistan or from the Taliban takeover leading to other problems there. But clearly, we are no longer on the same page when it comes to the US's actions there and the impact of what has happened after the pullout, because it does seem as if the threats for India have grown. So we have the threat of the Taliban in power, a government that is not very friendly to India's interests. In fact, in the past has been inimical. We have the threat of groups within Afghanistan. And by that, I don't just mean groups like Al-Qaeda or ISIS. I'm speaking specifically about groups like the Lashkar-e-Toyba and the Jaish-e-Mohammed, which in the past few years have taken bases in places like Kunar, in places like Helmand as well. The third big threat from there is really the export of terrorists into India. This is something that we just have to be much more, you know, preventive about. But also the emboldenment of radicalized groups. The idea that those groups in Afghanistan were able to defeat the US have already shown that they can defeat Russia, and now are dealing with a situation where none of these countries has an overweening power. The emboldenment is seen. In fact, most recently, if you ask me, the very, very brutal case of lynching in Pakistan by a mob supporting the Tehreek-e-Labbaik of Pakistan is essentially a kind of symptom of that larger problem of how radicalized groups feel more emboldened. This is going to be a worry for India as well. The second part of the threat from the Western frontier, as I said, is at the LOC. We are 5 years and more into absolutely no real dialogue with Pakistan. It's 5 years since the Uri attacks. There's an increased risk of misadventure there, although we have had, of course, a reaffirmed ceasefire this year at the LOC. The final part of this Western threat that I want to focus on, which perhaps we don't think about, is what does it mean that the world is kind of now increasingly looking away from Afghanistan? There's a kind of apathy for what is happening in Afghanistan and a kind of assumption that now the Taliban has taken over, we are more or less left without options. For India, it is not just a threat, as I said, of these physical threats, but a threat to the concept of the global war on terror that was launched in 2001. Because ever since 2001, India has been at least assured of the fact that the war against terror was a global enterprise, and that terrorists who attacked India were also terrorists of concern to the world. 20 years later, we are being told that the Taliban and its associates, people like the Haqqani group, that were actually a part, that were put onto the UN-sanctioned terrorist lists, we are being told that they are no longer terrorists. That not only are they no longer terrorists, that the places where they sought and received safe haven over the last 20 years will not be punished. In fact, they will not just not be punished, they will be encouraged, they will be asked to help with an exercise of speaking to these groups. And finally, there is the understanding that these very groups that for 20 years we thought we were all on the same page on are essentially now part of a government that not only is tolerated by the world, but I can tell you as of this week, there are 10 embassies that are open in Kabul. They have not recognized the regime there, but 10 embassies from 10 different countries actually operate in Kabul. I think for India, we have to think about what it means if the world is no longer looking at our threat of terrorism as part of the global problem, because that's something we've gotten used to. The next I'll turn to is the threat from China, but not much more needs to be said really after Professor Kondapalli has put it out there. But we do know the situation at the line of actual control, the transgressions by the PLA, 100,000 plus troops amassed on both sides of the LAC, the building of trenches, of infrastructure, bringing in even tanks near the LAC on the Chinese side, the construction of villages, coupled with why those villages are important when you come to the question of those new border laws, the new claims at the boundaries, putting aside old agreements, including something Bhutan is facing in its eastern Saktang sanctuary, and the inroads in India's neighborhood over the last decade or so. What we have seen China doing is in fact getting friendlier with India's neighbors. And today, and this is a study actually, if you were to look at the figures of 2013, 2014, and look at those figures today, China actually outpowers India on trade with each of its neighbors, except for Bhutan and I think Nepal for the moment. Investment in these countries, and I'll keep Bhutan to the side because of course they don't have relations. Tourism, pre-COVID, we were seeing more Chinese or at par with Indian tourists in these regions, as well as outgoing students. And now what China has tried to do through its United Front Works Department in terms of helping neighbors of India with COVID relief. The final part of this, again, I want to talk about what we don't really speak about, because we have heard from the government again and again saying China has done this at the line of actual control, but we still don't know why. We keep asking for reasons why. I think 20 months into this conflict, it is not possible for us to turn away from why China is doing this. What we need to do is look much more closely at its stated intentions, and some of those Professor Kondapalli referred to have come out in the party's Congress. One certainly is the general hegemonic trends of China that we see in various parts of the world, a kind of idea that we are moving away from 100 years of humiliation, that we have we will secure each of our traditional boundaries, our historical boundaries, and those include the five fingers around India. The second part, though, look closer at the LAC, is to deny India the ability to build more border infrastructure. The number of transgressions from China have increased simply because they can see that India has, in the last few years, been increasing its border infrastructure. The third is to deny India access to threaten in any way China's plans at expanding the Karakoram Highway and its plans for the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. This is a very significant line, which perhaps we don't look at straight away because we're just looking at our bilateral situation. The fourth is to deny any threats to Tibet and Xinjiang that abut this particular LAC. And of course, those who have traveled to Xinjiang or covered the story closely understand that for China, that is their biggest threat. It is where they see their highest threat perception from internally. And I think the fifth, again, something we don't really speak about, but is to deny India the ability to make good on what the Home Minister said in 2019 in August in Parliament, India's eventual plan to reunite with Pakistan-occupied Kashmir and Aksai Chin. So I think if we were to continue to say we don't understand why China is doing this, we would only be deluding ourselves. I'll turn very quickly now to the threat we have from other land boundaries, and that includes Bangladesh, Myanmar, Nepal. From Bangladesh, obviously, much better relations in the last few years, but we do still see threats along the boundary. More importantly, the threats of the Rohingya and possibly of more refugees from Myanmar as the internal situation there gets worse. Already we're seeing the protests in Myanmar being very brutally put down. Various regions are affected really by the Tatmadaw takeover of Myanmar in February this year. We are also seeing the impact on the Northeast when it comes to safe havens for groups that target the Northeast. In Nepal, this was a real collateral damage of what you were referring to, Marshal Mukul, the decision to reorganize Jammu and Kashmir. I think nobody was thinking that Nepal would be one of the collateral damage in the relationship, is what I mean, as a result of that. But essentially, it was because we decided to reorganize Jammu Kashmir and then to print new maps that Nepal's old dispute over Limpiodra and the other areas came to the fore again. In fact, we have seen Nepal's security forces arming their side of the boundary in a way we have not seen in the past. The road to Kailash Mansarovar became a trigger for tensions as well. And there is definitely a continuing tension in our ties between the two countries, another possible threat. And then there is the threat from the maritime front. One of the obvious threats that we look at is the PLAN and the kind of inroads they've made. The string of ports that China now runs from Djibouti to Gwadar to Hambantota to Chokpu, all the Belt and Road Initiative projects that could possibly be dual use that we have to look at. Also the problems of piracy and terror groups in the Indian Ocean. But the new threat that I think we should look at much more closely is the fallout of US-China tensions, particularly over Taiwan. We are already seeing more talk of a nuclearized, and I don't use that word lightly, Indian Ocean. When you see the US trying to counter China's presence in the Indian Ocean with its own AUKUS, Australia, UK, and US combine that seeks to put nuclear-powered submarines into the region, into the Indo-Pacific. And finally, and I hope you won't mind my bringing this into a subject which is essentially one of international and India's threats at its boundaries, there is the threat of the impact of India's own internal politics, which has a ripple effect, if you like, across the region. The reason I bring this up is for years, one of the reasons for India's predominance in its neighborhood has been its shining example as a democratic, as a pluralistic, as a magnanimous power in the region, in a sense. When that falters, when that image falters, our ability to deter threats from the region also reduce. I'll give you small examples. When India passed the Citizenship Amendment Act, for example, for the first time, we saw protests against India in a country like Afghanistan. This is pre-Taliban, of course. We saw the protests in Bangladesh. We see more recently protests in Maldives. We see diplomats and diplomacy on the back foot about telling, say, you know, Sri Lanka about treating its Tamil minorities, or Nepal about Madhesis in the constitution, or Bangladesh about the treatment of minorities there, giving Maldives suggestions on a better democracy in its country. That is all weakened, in a sense, when India itself does not look like a shining example to the region. And of course, what we see in Jammu and Kashmir then becomes a part of what particularly India's enemies are able to then use on an international stage. So at the end, I'd like to come to the idea that I began with, which is that we have to stop looking at this ring of fire as a kind of problem for India in the region, and instead start to think of it as a ring of security. What we certainly need, and we all understand that the situation with Pakistan is right now at an impasse. Diplomacy has not been able to move anywhere, regardless of you know, whether you are speaking or not speaking. There seems to be the threat of terror at all times from Pakistan. But the need to bring together the region in a multilateral forum, at least, is very necessary. Why is India still part of multilateral formats with China, from where there is obviously a much bigger threat today, while not continuing with the bilateral track for the moment, is exactly the same reason why India needs to continue its multilateral fora with Pakistan as well. Because it is necessary to understand that there are problems between us, but there are also bigger problems at the region. So whether it is the SAARC, which of course right now is not moving anywhere, or the Indian Ocean region, or others like BIMSTEC, we do need to look much, much more at these regional fora. I spoke about the idea of India being a magnanimous power in the region. This is also something that has taken a hit in the last few months, if you like. Things when India refuses, for example, to provide Sri Lanka with a debt repayment moratorium, stop taking debt repayments for the next 3 years, as they have asked, or whether India stops vaccines being supplied to Bangladesh and Nepal, who have paid for those vaccines in advance. I'm not saying we didn't have reasons for doing that. I'm just saying that we must see the repercussions of this. Or some years ago, the Nepal blockade. More recently, the idea that when Afghanistan saw this very, very troubling development, India's response was twofold. To bring Indians out, of course, the first, you know, first priority for any country. But then to shut down all visas that had been given, cancel every visa given to Afghans prior to that, ended up meaning that many Afghans who looked to India for leadership, for succor, for refuge in the middle of this storm were denied that. We have still not really opened out the visas. Less than 200 have been given out so far. These are things that actually do hurt India's, it's not just the soft power, because they increase the ability of our enemies to increase the threats to India. I think there is a need to acknowledge China's actions more openly. But as we do that, to understand that the resolution to the situation with China, whether it takes years or whether it is able to finish in months, is going to require a lot more diplomacy, not less. You referred, Emma Mukul, to the 18 conversations between Prime Minister Modi and President Xi Jinping prior to April 2020. It is necessary for us to also understand what were the kind of understandings that were passed there. Finally, we need to realize that when it comes to the neighborhood, it is not possible for India to say China is a threat to my neighborhood and therefore I need to team up with others. Because what we effectively do is we open a door for our neighbors to think India is not up to the challenge on its own. So while I know that it's very well well-intentioned, the idea that India will team up with the US or will team up with Japan to promote development in the region, to promote security in the region, what it essentially does is cut away from India's own agency. If we have learned anything from Afghanistan, it is that when the chips were down, it was US, Russia, China that were able to come together with Pakistan to decide the way forward for Afghanistan. This did not take into account India's threat perceptions, which have infinitely grown as a result of that formation. And I think it is necessary to say over here that if there is an answer to this, it is for India to not only seek a ring of security from its neighbors, but to project itself as the power in the region and find its voice there. Thank you.